I'm Laura Den Dulk. I'm a professor in public administration here at Erasmus University in the field of work organization and work-life issues. And I'm also a diversity officer of my faculty. And so I'm also trying to encourage more diversity and inclusion. When I look back at my own study time, when I started here at Erasmus, by the way, many years ago, I studied sociology here, and when I came, I was a first generation student, so the first in my family to go to university, and after that, fortunately, many nephews and cousins followed, but nevertheless, was the first. And I was excited, but also a bit insecure whether I would fit in, whether I could do it, you know, kind of, can I really be able to complete university study? And so I worked very, very hard at the beginning. That was my main focus. I did not engage in any student associations. I didn't feel so much attracted to them. So if you talk about sense of belonging, I really enjoyed studying and using my mind. And I was very, yeah, I loved sociology. It was the best choice ever for me. But for a long time to say I felt at home, no, it took me a really long time that I felt I really belong here in science. And also when I later did my PhD, I think it took me quite some time, and maybe because there were very few female role models. So I never envisioned a career in science. I just liked studying and liked doing research. I still do. And then I just kind of stayed within science. For me, it was the space in the academic space that took time, but the social space when I was studying was really, really, I had a great time as a student. But it's also partly related that sociology was also a small, diverse group of students, so you get to know each other very easily. And I think that's also a big challenge if you start studying economics or a law, where you have these big groups. Now it's much more difficult to get this social belonging, I think, if you are first generation student. But yeah, the academic space took me longer. But I also went to Rotterdam together with other friends from the place that I grew up that are also first generation students. So we also had each other. So I had multiple social spaces, I would say. I try when I'm giving lectures to really address everybody, to come up with examples that reflect different backgrounds. So that's not only my own background, but try to be more diverse, to pay attention to the cases I discuss within the classroom, to make sure, or to create an atmosphere that everybody feel welcome to ask a question, that there's no stupid question, so to speak. And also to create this warm and welcoming atmosphere, and then to try and interact with everybody. It's not always easy, because if you have a full lecture hall, it's very difficult, for instance, to get in touch with the students that's sitting in the back. But I try to walk around and try to engage everybody and give room to everybody. There are a few challenges if you look at creating a safe and inclusive learning environment. I think one of the important challenges is that we become aware that we have different background and interact and act in a certain way that we are used to, and that we should become aware of our implicit bias, that we all have stereotypes, that we all have that implicit bias. When we interact with each other, with students, when you see somebody, you make something up in your mind that, oh, that person is probably a professor, that person is an assistant or a student or a good student or a less functioning student. You all make that up in your mind, and you're often not aware of your own stereotypes and biases. So it's crucial that we become aware of them. I think the most important thing is to challenge those every day, in our interaction, that you try to stay this open-minded and have this open conversation and dialogue, and that you can also, if you talk with somebody and somebody is kind of criticizing you, you know, you don't use gender-sensitive language or don't feel so much appreciated in the way you talk about certain things during a lecture, for instance, that you don't feel offended, but that you are just, you know, try to be, to listen and to understand and to see and to reflect on your own teaching. So this, in a sense, is a continuous behavior or attitudes you need to have to kind of be prepared to question and to be prepared also to be a bit vulnerable, to acknowledge that you can also make mistakes or maybe, was assuming things, well, that might be different. But if there is dialogue, that's no problem. Huh? We can just talk about it. So that's very important, and it's something that you need to learn. I think we need training for this. And it's also, I think, in these times, I think it's also very important if we don't agree on things, because that happens, we can see that all, that we have a good conversation about it and not polarized, you know, that we get them and us and I'm not agreeing, yes, no, kind of conversation, but that we really try to understand each other's perspectives and we can talk about it. We don't need to agree all the time, but that we can talk about it. And I think that's part of being an academic. I think leadership is crucial to foster the sense of belonging, but also diversity and inclusion. They need to be role models to kind of, in their own behaviors, show they appreciate diversity and they want to encourage sense of belonging, that they are open to any questions and new perspectives. But also being supportive if anybody has trouble with finding his way or getting connected or to other staff members, to become part of this community. So, we know from research how important leaders are in changing as well the organizational culture in a more inclusive and safe culture that everybody feel respected and belong to. From my own research, based on my own research on work-life issues, for centuries, for decades, organizations kind of have this ideal model of the ideal employee, that is a male employee, always available, who has no other responsibilities in life except work. We might have a family at home, but then that's taken care of by his wife. So this was kind of the stereotype ideal worker. And that's still ingrained in many organizational cultures. So as soon as an organization, you start to think, hey, maybe my employees have a different life outside work. And their work is also impacted by that life outside work and vice versa, of course. And then you open up, so it's not only a gendered issue, so acknowledging that women have caring responsibilities for children and often do the main burden of that caring responsibility, although they might share, because men, there are many young men in particular that would like to share, but they are not viewed as also carers, they are viewed as workers. But as soon as you open up that space, that there is a world outside work that also, you know, people take that with them, then you can broaden that scope, not only look at that as a combination of work and care, but also what kind of cultural activities are people doing, how do they live their life outside work, and what do they bring with them inside work. And if you start to talk about it and be interested about it, and also, you know, in your policy development, acknowledge that diversity of people, so that everybody is able to work, at most productive and with a lot, in a satisfying way, then you, of course, not only attract good employees, but you also keep them in your organization. So but of course, organizational culture, to change that, that's a very difficult thing to do. And I think also there, it's also about dialogue. It's about policies, but it's about dialogue. And I think leadership has a very important say in that.